Dear students, welcome to Tungala online classes. Today I am going to start with the third chapter, that is human reproduction, right? So already you have gone through the two chapters, so that is the first one is reproduction in organisms. It's a general topic in which how the reproduction that occurs in different groups of organisms, so both the lower organisms as well as higher organisms that you have studied. And in the second chapter, particularly we have chosen the angiosperms, that is how the sexual type of reproduction that occurs in case of angiosperms, that we have studied in thorough. And in the third chapter, that is human reproduction, how the mechanism of a sexual type of reproduction that occurs in case of human being, that we are going to learn in detailed way in this chapter. All right, let us start with the third chapter. Chapter number 3, human reproduction. Human beings are the higher animals, especially. So in these animals, so sexual type of reproduction occurs over here. What kind of reproduction occurs here? Sexual type of reproduction occurs in case of human being. Sexual type of reproduction that occurs. Okay. So during the study of this sexual type of reproduction in case of human being, what are the sequential events that are occurring during human reproduction? So these are the events that we'll have to study one by one, right? As well as what are the structures that we study, anatomical structures, what we study regarding this human reproduction, all those things. So we go on writing first. So first of all, we'll see the scenario of this human reproduction. I mean, all the steps, whatever we are going to study over here, all are written first. So, and understand what happens in every step, and later, so we'll study each step in detail, right? So let us start with the synopsis of this chapter. Very important thing to be remembered, right? Synopsis of this chapter, the first synopsis. That is the first structure what we are going to learn over here is male reproductive system. We are studying. And the second one is female reproductive system that we are going to study. Here in male reproductive system, what are the structures that we come across? So that we study in thorough. And female reproductive system, what are the different types of structures that we come across, all those structures that we study in detailed manner. After this one, so whenever we study the reproductive systems, and these reproductive systems in which there we come across special structures. So the special structures which are going to form the gametes, right? Those structures which are going to form the gametes are called as gonads, right? So let us study in the next step, that is gametogenesis in respective gonads. Gametogenesis is nothing but the process of formation of gametes in respective gonads. In respective male as well as female gonads is called as gametogenesis. And this gametogenesis process that occurs in both male as well as females. And in males, one gamete is formed, that gamete is called as sperm. The process of production of a sperm itself is called as what? Spermatogenesis is the first step. So in case of males, right, sperms are produced over here. It is occurring in case of male in respective gonad, that is a testis. And second one is oogenesis. That is in case of female. the process of formation of ovum or egg cell in the ovary is called as what? Is called as oogenesis, that occurs in case of female, right? So this is also a very important point to be noted over here. And the fourth point to be noted, after gametogenesis, remember we studied the male reproductive system and female reproductive system respectively, and in these systems there are some structures are there, specialized structures called as primary sex organs, that we call them as, they are nothing but gonads, and these gonads are helping for the production of sperms as well as egg cell in case of males as well as females. That process itself is called as what? Gametogenesis. Spermatogenesis as well as oogenesis are the two types of gametogenesis. And after the gamete formation, there one of the important point to be noted in case of females, there are some cyclical changes that occur every month in the female, in the reproductive organs, right? So of the females, and that those cyclical changes that occur in the reproductive tract of the female are called as menstrual cycle, or together called as menstrual cycle. That is very important point in this chapter, that is menstrual cycle. Menstrual cycle, it is also one of the important so event what happens over here in case of only the females that we study in detail, right? And along with this one, one more point to be noted during menstrual cycle, so there are some hormonal control that occurs, or hormonal release that occurs. How the hormonal control that occurs during the course of this menstrual cycle, that also we are going to study over here. That is hormonal control during menstrual cycle. Menstrual cycle, this is also one more event that we are going to study in this chapter. And in the next chart, next step, so what is the very important one? Already we have studied spermatogenesis, where the sperms are produced, oogenesis, where the egg cell is produced. After the production of gametes, what happens there? Insemination occurs. What occurs? Insemination. What do you mean by insemination? The question arises. This is nothing but the process of deposition of the sperms into the reproductive tract of the female, right? Is called as what? Insemination. Semen is a thick, whitish, gelatinous substance that contains plenty number of sperms in it, and that is produced by what? By the male, and this is introduced into the female reproductive tract, and that process itself is called as what? Insemination. And as a result of insemination, the sperms entered into the reproductive tract of the female now, right? This is also one more event that we are going to study now. And after the insemination, what is the thing happens over here? Sixth point, very important point. After the insemination, all the sperms what are there deposited inside the female reproductive tract, they start to run towards the egg cell, where they meet the egg cell. After meeting of the egg cell, so there one of the sperms fertilizes the egg cell, and the process itself is called as what? Fertilization. What is that? Fertilization is the next event what happens so during the human reproduction. So now the fertilization has taken place over here. After the fertilization, so the cell became, means male as well as female gametes fused themselves so as to form the zygote. Now the zygote start to develop into an embryo. There are certain developmental stages of the embryo that we study after the fertilization over here. And what are those developmental study of the developmental stages of the embryogenesis? After fertilization, the seventh important point is embryogenesis. What do you mean by embryogenesis? The name itself suggests embryo means embryo, genesis means production, formation, right? That is the process of formation of embryo that starts. There we come across a certain developmental stages during the embryogenesis. All those developmental stages, what happens during embryogenesis, I am going to write over here in detailed way. First one is cleavage. Whatever the zygote that is formed as a result of the zygote, what is formed as a result of fertilization, this zygote undergoes mitotic division. Continuous mitotic division so as to form multicellular, right? So, wall of mass of the cell, right? And that continuous mitotic division itself is called as what? Cleavage, means zygote undergoes cleavage, continuous mitotic division, so as to form the next step itself is morula. A group of 8 to 16 or 16 to 32 celled stage that occurs over here, that is called as what? Morula. After the morula, the next step itself is blastula. Next developmental stage itself is blastula, and after the formation of the blastula, the next step itself is what? Gastrulation. That is nothing but here process of formation of blastula is called as blastulation, and process of formation of gastrula itself is called as what? Gastrulation. Alright, so this is how the developmental stages that occurs during embryogenesis. See here, in the middle point, what we have to point out over here is, whenever the embryo reaches the developmental stage called as blastula, and this blastula in case of human being is called as blastocyst. Why? Because it looks to be as a cyst-like structure, and this blastula so goes and it attaches to the uterine wall, that is endometrial wall. That process itself is called as what? Implantation. Here we study what? Implantation. What happens over here? Implantation. The attachment of the blastocyst to the endometrial wall is called as what? Implantation. Implantation occurs over here. This is also one of the important event what happens during human reproduction, right? So after the implantation, the gastrulation occurs over here, and after the implantation, one more point to be noted over here, that is nothing but the process of formation of placenta, that is placentation. What happens over here? Placentation occurs over here. After the placentation, the gastrulation occurs over here. And after the gastrulation, what happens over here is, after the gastrulation, all the three germ layers are formed. What are formed here? Germ layers. After the formation of the germ layers, what happens over here is, all the germ layers, that is ectoderm, mesoderm, as well as endoderm, are the three germ layers that are formed over here, and all these three germ layers which develop different types of organs in the baby, developing embryo, right? So that is responsible. Ectoderm is responsible for the formation of skin-like structures. Different organs, that is mesoderm as well as endoderm, is also same, and it leads to what? Organogenesis. What is that? Organogenesis. Organogenesis, so here development of organs take place, or the formation of organs that takes place over here. Right, so here formation of organs that take place in all these, during the course of all these events, what we studied here is insemination. After the insemination, fertilization occurs. Fertilization leads to zygote formation. Zygote undergoes mitotic division, continuous mitotic division, so as to form So the process called as cleavage, and after the cleavage the morula formation take place and blastula formation take place. Blastula undergo implantation, and implantation leads to formation of the placenta. After the placentation, gastrulation occurs, germ layer formation occurs, all the germ layers I have written over here, and that leads to what? Organogenesis. See here, after fertilization, whenever the zygote is formed and whenever this blastulation, all these are the developmental stages of the embryo that occurs over here. So these developmental stages confirm. What it confirms, what it confirms here is pregnancy. What it confirms? Pregnancy. So here, after the pregnancy, the developmental stages occurs over here. Alright? So this is the fact what we must understand first. So, and whatever the developmental stages that we come across from the blastocyst implantation process, from this stage up to the formation of organs in the baby, right? So, and the baby is ready to come out of the womb of the mother, right? And that process of ejection of the baby from the womb of the mother itself is called as parturition, right? What it is called as? Parturition. So now, after the organogenesis, what happens? A fully formed baby is ready, fully developed baby is ready in the womb of the mother, and that stimulates as well as the placenta also stimulates, so the baby to come out of the body, and that process itself is called as what? Parturition. What it is called as? Parturition. So that is nothing but delivery of the baby, what we call it as in general, right? Parturition occurs. Soon after the parturition, so what happens? A baby came to the new world itself, right? So when it comes outside, it should be nourished. For that reason, in case of mammals, as the name says, mama means breast, right? So breast having animals, these mammals are, especially females have these breasts in which the production of the milk that occurs, and production of milk after production, so they have been ejected out of the what? The mammary glands of the female, and when it ejects out, it is being sucked by the baby through the nipples which are present at the tip of the mammary glands, right? And that process itself is called as what? Lactation. That process itself is called as lactation. This is how we study the human reproduction under all these side headings, right? So these are all synopsis of this chapter. Every synopsis we must remember, then we are able to learn this chapter very well, right? And we will be so thorough in this chapter, right? If we know all these synopsis, right? So then we are able to explain every step very easily if you remember all these steps over here. I hope you have understood. So partially, what are the things that are happening during human reproduction, right? So what are the things, what are the synopsis of this chapter you came to know? This chapter is very, very important as far as theory examination is pointed out, as well as competitive examination is also pointed out. So in point of these two factors, so this chapter is very important and it is very interesting. Why? Because these are all physiological activities what happens so during the course of the life of ourselves. So that is nothing but human being, right? So that's why it's very interesting for us. And let us start with the first point, that is male reproductive system, right? So male reproductive system is studied first. And before going to start with this male reproductive system, so we must know these animals, I mean human beings, are so following sexual type of reproduction already have mentioned. And so these are exhibiting sexual dimorphism is also very important point to be noted over here. What is sexual dimorphism? sexual dimorphism. What do you mean by it? Sexual dimorphism is nothing but we can easily differentiate the male as well as females in case of human being by seeing the external features, right? And this is called as what? Sexual dimorphism. It is the phenomenon in which we are able to differentiate males as well as females by seeing the external features, right? Is called as what? Sexual dimorphism is very important point to be noted over here. And one more point to be noted over here, there we come across two steps over here during the study of this human reproduction. We must remember what are those two steps itself is. One is prenatal events and second one is postnatal events. So these two events that we must remember always. What is mean by natal in the sense that, what do you mean by natal? Natal stands for birth. Natal stands for birth, means prenatal events. Prenatal means before the birth of the baby, what are the events all are taking place. So those events that we must go through. And postnatal events. Postnatal means after the birth, what are the events that happens over here? That we know it better, that is nothing but lifespan. In the first chapter, we have studied the definition of lifespan. And a lifespan is nothing but it is the period between the birth as well as the natural death of the individual organism, that we know it better. That is nothing but postnatal events, right? So in this, up to the what? The birth of the baby, what are those events that are occurring? All those events that we study in this chapter in detail, right? So these are all things that we must go through in this chapter. I hope you have understood partially. So what we are going to learn in this chapter, right? So let us start with the first topic, that is male reproductive system. Now, yes. Male reproductive system. Let us start with. And what is this male reproductive system consisting of? Let us see one by one. Right? So it consisting of the primary sex organs. It consists of the primary sex organs. So these primary sex organs are those organs which are able to produce the gametes as well as the hormones, male sex hormones they are said as, and such kind of organs which are able to produce the gametes, male gametes as well as male hormones, male sex hormones, are called as primary sex organs in males, right? So these primary sex organs, they are nothing but a pair of testes. A pair of testes are said to be as primary sex organs, right? In which the production of sperms take place and the production of androgens, that is the testosterone hormone, take place. That is male androgen, male sex hormones they are called as. Hence, these are primary sex organs, the first structure. And the second structure itself is secondary sex organs. It includes what? It includes secondary sex organs. What are these secondary sex organs? Are also named as accessory organs, accessory ducts, as well as accessory glands. It includes, so very important point to be noted over here, it includes accessory ducts as well as accessory glands. It includes, right? These are very important point we noted over here. What are the ducts that are assisted for the male reproductive system for the passing of all these sperms or the semen itself? So they are nothing but accessory ducts. And accessory glands are those glands which secrete something, and that is helpful for the formation of what? The semen, a thick whitish milky structure called as semen, which includes that contains plenty number of sperms within it. So they are said to as what? Accessory glands. So like this, accessory ducts as well as accessory glands are present. So both together form the secondary sex organs. Then list out, so what are the accessory ducts that are present over here? What are the accessory glands that are present over here in the male reproductive system? Ducts are, so first one is rete testis. Rete testis of the ducts. And the second one is vasa efferentia. Vasa efferentia is there. Vasa efferentia as well as rete testis as well as vasa deferentia. Vasa deferentia. Vasa deferens is also called as vasa deferentia is there. So rete testis is there, vasa efferentia are there. So these are nothing but along with this one epididymis. Epididymis. So this is also the accessory duct it is. So rete testis, and second one is vasa efferentia, third one is vasa deferentia, fourth one is epididymis. These are nothing but accessory ducts that are present in male reproductive system. And accessory glands, what are the accessory glands present over here? First one is seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles. A pair of seminal vesicles are there, and prostate gland is there. And the third one is Cowper's glands. So like this, Cowper's glands, prostate glands, as well as seminal vesicles, these are the accessory glands present in male reproductive system. This is the second part. What is that? So primary sex organs and secondary sex organs, and third one is a very important one. What is the third one? It is also said to be as external genitalia. What is external genitalia in case of human being? It's very important one. It is nothing but it is a penis, right? Penis is external genitalia, right? So all these are the things that we study thoroughly one by one, right? So these are very important aspect to be remembered. And so 1-5 mark questions that occurs from this male reproductive system, they ask the question to draw the male reproductive system, right? So in detail we'll go through this one, all right? So the first one is primary sex organs. What are the primary sex organs? They are a pair of testes. What are there? A pair of testes are there. Where they are located, how they are, what is their size, everything will go on studying in detail, right? So let us start with the first one, that is primary sex organ. That is nothing but testes. The structure of testes we are going to study now, right? How is the structure of this testes and where they are located are very important point to be noted over here. So let us draw the diagram initially. This is one testes and this is another testes. Like this. So these a pair of testes are lying inside what? They are lying inside the they are lying inside the sac-like structure called as scrotal sacs. What these are named as? Scrotal sacs, inside which a pair of testes are lying. One is a little lower and another one is a little higher. So there is an imbalance is there. I hope it is not so clearly visible to you. Now I shall draw the same diagram over here. So, okay. This is slightly lower and this is slightly upper in right, inside which what are present, a pair of testes are present over here. These pair of testes are oval in shape, right? So let us go on writing the detailed structure of this testes. A pair of testes are present over here, and they are present inside the thin pigmented skin, which makes the pouches like structure or the sac like structures called as scrotal sacs, right? So these are present inside the scrotal sacs. They are present inside the scrotal sacs. And these pair of testes are lying below the abdomen. They are lying below the abdomen or pelvic region. These testes are lying below the abdomen, right? They are lying below the abdomen, means they are lying or hanging below the abdomen, and they are inside the scrotal sacs, right? So what a scrotum is, the question arises here. Scrotum itself is nothing but it is a thin pigmented pinkish skin that makes the pouch like structure or the sac like structure called as scrotal sacs, right? Scrotum is a thick pigmented, pinkish skin or dark skin which makes the pouch-like or sac-like structures called scrotal sacs. What it is called as? Scrotal sacs. It makes the scrotal sacs. That is nothing but a scrotum it is called as. And this scrotum has a cavity. Scrotum has cavity here, and this cavity, it is not visible here, I shall draw here. So this cavity is called as vaginal coelom. Vaginal coelom it is named as. It is named as vaginal coelom, and this vaginal coelom is filled with a special kind of what? A tissue. It is filled with a special type of tissue. And this tissue is named as, so it is a fluid in nature, hence it is hydrocele. It is named as hydrocele. And so this scrotal sac itself is lined with what? It's very important one. It is lined with dorsal muscle, dorsus muscles. It is lined by Scrotum is lined by, I shall write here one by one. So very important one. What is that? Dartus muscles. Very important one. Dartus muscles. And second one is also very important one. What it is also lined with is a very important one. So before that one, so let us discuss what is this Dartus muscle help for. It helps in regulation of the temperature. It helps in the regulation of temperature. Dartus muscles are helping for the regulation of temperature. Why? Because so this scrotum, which is descending from the abdomen, it descends down the abdominal part, and this has the temperature which is less than the body temperature, right? It is about 2 degrees centigrade to 2.5 degrees centigrade less temperature is noted in scrotum. In scrotum, it is less than the body temperature, means our body temperature itself is 37 degrees centigrade, and so here in this 2 to 2.5 degrees centigrade is less, means it is about 35 degrees centigrade, and that is the temperature which is suitable for the production of sperms. It is the temperature which is suitable for production of sperms inside the testes. It is the suitable temperature for the production of the sperms inside the testes, right? This is more important point to be noted as NEET examination is pointed out here. So NEET point it is, right? Note down this point very carefully, right? So what is that? Dartus muscles, which help in regulation of the temperature, right? So, and one more point to be noted here is spermatic fascia is also one more lining that we come across here. Spermatic fascia. Spermatic fascia is also one more important muscle fiber lining that you come across over here, right? And cremaster is the next important point. What is that? Cremaster is very important point. And this cremaster is helpful for what? So this is helpful for the elevation of these testes whenever they are chilled more, right? So this is helpful for elevation of testes. Cremaster is helpful for the elevation of the testes whenever the testes temperature becomes too low when compared to the so body temperature, that is less than 35 degrees centigrade when it goes on. That moment what happens? So during rainy season or winter season, it is happening so. So that moment these testes are elevated up. So they are elevated up and they come very close to the abdomen. When they come to the close to the abdomen, that moment they receive the temperature from the abdominal part of the body. So that the rise in the temperature in this area, that is scrotal sacs, they take place. And once again, whenever they gain the temperature, they descend down once again, right? So this is how the elevation and descending of these testes take place, and the regulation of the temperature that take place because of these Dartus muscles, right? So this is very important point. So scrotal sac is lined with all these three important layers. One is Dartus muscles, and spermatic fascia also called as one kind of muscles, and cremaster is one more. right? All these three linings of the scrotal sac is very important now. These pair of testes are being connected with the abdominal cavity or abdomen with the help of a canal called as inguinal canal. Suppose this is the canal, which is said to be as inguinal canal, and this canal is also having spermatic cord. There the spermatic cord is also present in this inguinal canal. Through this inguinal canal, the spermatic cord, so that it enters in, means it is directly connected to the what? The testes. From the testes, this spermatic cord, it is a cord like structure that is connected to the abdomen, right? Suppose this is the testes. From this testes, this cord that passes like this, and this is cord spermatic cord, whenever we take the cross section of it, so that moment you will find one nerve is present in the spermatic cord, and vas deferens is also passing over here. Vasa deferentia is passing through this spermatic cord. One nerve is there. Nerve is connected to the testes from the abdominal part, right? And one artery is there, one vein is there. This is vein and this is artery. Artery is there, vein is there, along with that one was deferentia is also passing through this cord, and that cord is called as spermatic cord. That spermatic cord is also passing through the inguinal canal and connected to the abdominal part, right? So these are descending down the abdominal part, hence these are also described as means a pair of testes as well as scrotum is also described as an extra abdominal part, right? An extra abdominal part, and this is a pair of testes it is having, and pair of testes are hidden inside, or it is descending inside a sac like structure called a scrotal sac, and it is lined by so and so linings, and they helpful for so and so things, and so these are so having the inguinal canal to connect the abdominal part, and through the inguinal canal spermatic cord that passes, and each spermatic cord consisting of a nerve, an artery, a vein, as well as vasa deferentia. All these are the things that it consisting of, through which the testes are connected to the abdominal part, right? So this is very important point to be noted. And one more point we noted here is, so these testes are supported by the peritoneum. They are supported by the peritoneum called as mesorchium. It is a very important point to be noted. Mesorchium is the name of the peritoneum. Mesorchium is the name of the peritoneum, so which supports these testes. It's a very important point, right? So all these are the things that we must remember regarding these testes. And one more certain so terms that we come across over here, what are those terms? First one is cryptorchism. What do you mean by cryptorchism? The term says that, or else it is defined as, right, the undescended condition of the testes itself is said to be as cryptorchidism, right? So this is one point to be noted over here. I shall write the conditions over here. Cryptorchidism. Undescended condition. All right, undescended condition of the testis is said to be as what? Cryptorchidism. One more is archaeopexy, right? This very important point. Archaeopexy is another term. What do you mean by archaeopexy? So surgically we can make these testes to descend into the scrotal sac, right? These testes are descended into the scrotal sac surgically. Whenever they are not descended, that moment it has been done, and that surgery itself is termed as what? Archaeopexy, right? So the third one. So here sometimes in case of bulls, so as to handle these animals, ferocious animals, if they have a testis and there is a secretion of the androgens that is taking place in these animals, that moment the animal is very ferocious, right? So that is why, so as to tame these animals, such kind of ferocious animals, so as to tame them, so we crush the testis of these animals. So, and so as to stop the the copulation, and so as to tame these animals, so there is a crushing of the animals testis is being done, and this is called as castration, right? Very important one, castration. Crushing of the testis has been done in case of bulls especially, right? And these are very important terms, remember them, right? So after this one, in case of rodentia, in case of Chiroptera, right, in these groups of animals especially, the descending of the testes take place only during the breeding season. During only the breeding season, the descending of the testes that take place, so that the sperm production that continues. So until that breeding season, these testes are usually present inside the abdomen in case of Chiroptera as well as Rodentia. Note down this point also. Chiroptera and Rodentia means rats as well as bats. In these conditions, so what happens? The testes are being in the abdomen until the occurrence of the breeding season. During breeding season, they descend down and sperm production starts, right? This is one more point. And in case of elephant, one exceptional thing is there. In case of elephants, what happens here is a testis are present in the abdominal part only. That's why there are no scrotal sacs present in case of elephants, you might have observed, right? So that's why the scrotal sacs are vestigial in nature in case of elephants, right? This is also a very important point to be noted over here. So this is all about the external features of this testis. And one more point I left over here is these testes are connected by a special structure called as a special type of a structure that connects over here is called as guberniculum. It is called as guberniculum, so that the testes are being in their respective area only, right? This is also one more point to be noted over here. Guberniculum. What it is called as? Guberniculum, right? Okay. Yes, so till now whatever we discuss, so regarding this male reproductive system itself is a primary sex organ, right? So how is its external features as well as all other terminologies related? So all those things that we discussed, and in the next video, we are going to study about the internal structure of these testes and how is the internal structure of these testes. Seeing that one, we'll go to the secondary sexual organs as well as the next one is external genitalia. Thank you. Thank you very much.